Welcome everyone to my presentation. My name is Marcin Zajączkowski, and today I will refer to the article titles in media, spreading uncertainty about the lack of long-term support, free long-term support for Java, questioning if Java can be still used for free, or even more, predicting the imminent end of Java in general. Of course, some articles in media, in the internet, reliably refer the whole situation. However, even Oracle doesn't help sending that kind of letters, which can be vaguely understood. Working with my clients in the previous months, I clearly see that there are some doubt remained, and therefore, today I will summarize the possible long-term support options for Java 8 and 11, all just in 20 minutes. I wasn't able to pack it up in 15 minutes, so I hope it will be worth staying 5 minutes longer with me instead of lunch. And just a quick few words about myself. I specialize in automatic code testing, continuous delivery, reactive stuff. Occasionally I write blog posts, and I conduct trainings also about Java 11. I cooperate with Botega IT Minds, very interesting training and consulting company. In my presentation, there will be something about the development of our Java and OpenJDK, about the licensing, and of course, possible support options. Let's start with some historical background. And Java is a proprietary software created in late 90s. However, as it became popular, there were attempts to create open source implementation of Java. Notably, there were GNU ClassPath and Apache Harmony. However, in the end, in 2006, Sun decided to release their own implementation of Java on GPL, and the project OpenJDK was created to be a reference implementation of Java Standard Edition. However, not everything could be released as open source due to some legal issues, and Project IT emerged to fill those incompatible parts with open source replacement. In the following years, other companies joined the OpenJDK train and became starting to contribute to OpenJDK projects. The highest point of this movement was 2018, when the binaries provided by Oracle of Oracle JDK are built from OpenJDK sources. Therefore, there is no more proprietary functionality in Oracle JDK, such as Java Mission Control, and it's, let's say, equal, the binaries are equal to OpenJDK binaries. However, there were some issues. First of all, there is TCK, it's technology compatibility kit. It's a kind of software test used to test if your some other Java implementation is compatible with the specification. And at the beginning, it was only available to the companies who has licenses of Java from Sun and Oracle. However, after the OpenJDK was released on GPL, it was also available for other OpenJDK implementations based on OpenJDK. However, it was not for everyone because some other open source implementations, such as Apache Harmony, was not able to use that TCK to verify that they are compatible with the specification. Another issue is the fact that starting with 2018 or 19, the Oracle JDK binaries are no longer free for use. You cannot use it in production. You need to pay Oracle some license fee. There are also trademark issues with JEE, Jakarta EE. However, it's not the topic of that presentation, so let's skip it. To be on the same page, Java is the set of specification software created by Sun, later trademarked by Oracle, and there is Java Platform Standard Edition, base part of Java, which we usually use with some additions, and Oracle JDK is binaries available from Oracle. OpenJDK is the mainstream upstream project as a reference implementation of Java Standard Edition, But also we have some other implementation of the virtual machine, such as OpenJ9, which is an alternative to Hotspot. I will come back to that later on. And looking at the OpenJDK development, of course, there is Oracle, the main power behind Java. However, it is done with the help of external contributors. And here's a screenshot from the Mark Reinhold presentation at FOSDEM. He's the OpenJDK lead. And we clearly see that, of course, Oracle is the biggest company behind Java, but there are some other companies which provide a contribution to the project. And it's another screenshot from Bellsoft, where we see that some code, some contribution from other companies is quite important. Of course, Oracle did 20 times more to Java, but it's not only Oracle. And having OpenJDK in development in mind, you need to remember that currently only the latest version of Java is maintained by Oracle. The previous versions, including Java 11, are maintained by other companies, currently mostly Red Hat. So, of course, all with the help from external contributors. Talking about support, I would like to summarize two things. We have two distinguished kind types of support. First of all, public updates. Therefore, it's a situation when we can get some free updates, which include security fixes. Why security fixes are mostly related to Java Web Start, which is currently deprecated, but there are also some issues with deserialization in the past and a wide range of application servers, or in general, Java backend server edition was vulnerable to those issues. In addition, we have bug fixes and enhancements. For example, Docker support. Starting with Java 8, it was possible to run, with Java 8 at the beginning, it was possible to run Docker, Java inside Docker. However, most likely the application was killed very quickly because there was a problem with C group's constraints. It was improved in Java 9, 10, and 11. However, most of the fixes were backported to Java 9, to Java 8. And currently, having the current version of Java, it is quite simple to run a Java application. It's much better than a few years ago with starting version of Java. Therefore, bug fixes and enhancements are important to get. The second type of support is so-called extended support. It's in addition to have updates, we also have a promise to get some help from the supporting team, engineering team of our vendor. And of course, the quality of that depends on, it's not so bright. However, at least in the case of OpenJDK, if we have some problems, issues, bugs spotted in OpenJDK, those bugs should be fixed quicker than normal bugs. And usually it works. However, it's extra paid service and most of us do not use it. From those two kinds of support, I definitely recommend to have at least to recommend the first one, especially for that kind of important stuff as the Java, because you most likely would not have to be forced to fix some security issues in OpenJDK, not supported version for OpenJDK, as it's not in Java mostly, it's C++, and we would like to do some more interesting things than digging into source code of OpenJDK to fix some strange security issue. Talking more about licensing, the binaries, as I already mentioned, Oracle JDK binaries are built from the original OpenJDK sources, and the extra stuff, such as Java Flight Recorder or Java Mission Control, were extracted to the third-party projects and are available for free as open-source projects, so it's nice. However, Oracle JDK is no longer free for production use. Starting from the April this year, also Oracle JDK 8 binaries are no longer available for free. And what is even more problematic, Oracle doesn't provide supported version of OpenJDK for longer than 6 months. It's also for long-term support versions. Therefore, effectively, we don't have long-term support for OpenJDK from Oracle anymore. So what should we do? Yes, be aware of downloading OpenJDK, Oracle JDK 8, and what we can do. We can update our Java version in production every 6 months. However, for most of them, especially commercial projects, it's not an option. So we need to do something else. For example, you can pay Oracle for extended support. Depending on the number of CPUs or cores, it can be some significant amount of money. But the third option is to find some other vendor providing long-term support for our Java JDK. And luckily, there are both free and paid options to choose from. First of all, Red Hat is the platinum sponsor of this conference, but it's also the most active external contributor to OpenJDK, and currently the leader of OpenJDK 8 and 11, and they declared to provide extended support for Java 8 and Java 11, and the binaries are TCK verified, so it's in general it's very nice. In addition, they are available for free. Therefore, you can download binaries of OpenJDK by Red Hat, and we can use it even in production. It's not a problem. The binaries are available for Red Hat compatible products, so CentOS, Fedora, RHEL, and Windows. In addition, there is commercial support for RHEL binaries and for Windows binaries of OpenJDK. Therefore, if you have already a subscription for Red Hat, it's quite possible because OpenShift, RHEL, and other middleware subscription from Red Hat gives you automatically support for OpenJDK from Red Hat. Therefore, having a subscription for Red Hat services, it's quite convenient to use that distribution of OpenJDK because we have support for free, or at least within the price we already paid. A small glitch is that having some non-RPM Linux distribution, such as Debian or Ubuntu, or having Mac, there are no binaries provided by Red Hat, and we need to find something else in that case. Another interesting option is Adopt OpenJDK. It's an initiative founded in 2017, which supported by different companies and organizations, and they built binaries of OpenJDK for a variety of platforms. They also promised to provide long-term support for Java, and the binaries are available for free. In addition, you can get commercial support for those binaries from other companies, so it's a nice option. And in a case you are not affiliated with any other vendor which you already have paid for support for something else, Adopt OpenJDK is a very interesting option to follow. There is some issue, after some legal issues with Oracle, the binaries are no longer TCK verified. Therefore, Adopt OpenJDK is not officially cannot be officially named as compatible with Java, but those are the same sources built from the main source repository, so it should be not a problem. Of course, we need to mention Oracle JDK. It's the main company behind Java, so the guys know what to do, but you need to remember you cannot use it in production for free. However, again, having some subscription for example, for Oracle Cloud, you have a subscription or you can use Oracle JDK for free or within the price. Therefore, in a situation you have some web logic or database from Oracle, maybe it's a good option to ask about the price discount, or maybe you can just use it within the subscription you already have. Of course, there are some other vendors to follow, and in alphabetical order, we have Amazon Cureto. It's internally used by Amazon, And if you have some subscription for AWS, you can also have support for that distribution of OpenJDK. Another is Azul and Zulu. It's another interesting company with a long lasting experience in Java virtual machine. Again, we also with commercial support, but again, available for free as binaries. We have Bellsoft and Liberica JDK. They are interesting because they provide support for some strange or not very popular architecture, such as 22-bit ARM processors. And in addition, it's the company which provides support for OpenJDK used in JetBrains products. We have SAP. I have no experience with that OpenJDK. And we can also use some distributions, some binaries from our Linux distribution. Therefore, having, for example, Fedora, we can use Fedora binaries. However, you need to pay attention how good the support for that version is provided, because recently some Deb-based distribution, there were issues with another version of Java, therefore it's not always the best possible solution. Of course, we have a bunch of others, such as the brand new OpenJDK binaries from Pivotal announced recently. To wrap it up, I would say that the future of Java is not so bad as some articles mentioned at the beginning. And even more for me, the situation is quite good, because Java is even more open source than it was in the past. Some extra proprietary software are currently available for free as open source. And in addition, we have it caused that some other vendors provide support for Java for free or for money. And therefore, it's not only Oracle, but many more vendors started to provide that kind of support, which is nice for the ecosystem. In addition, it's worth to remember that in the end, all security fixes and important changes should be backported to the official source code of OpenJDK. Therefore, in the majority of cases, it's just a matter of time when your updated binaries will have that security fix. Therefore, the choice of the vendor of your OpenJDK distribution, it can be not as important as it could be. However, we need to pay attention to business relationships. As I said, if you have subscription for something that provides you support for OpenJDK, it's nice. In addition, you could get some extra features available or out-of-sync builds for security fixes. And so you need to pay attention, choosing a vendor of OpenJDK, you should pay attention to some other benefits that you can have from that vendor. Therefore, my recommendation is to choose a vendor which is the most friendly to your to your software and licensing relationships that you already have. And in a case you don't have that kind of products, I recommend to use adopt OpenJDK, which seems to be very stable and long-lasting provider or vendor of OpenJDK. And I'm almost on time, so thank you for watching my presentation, and have a nice lunch after that.